You've got to put mine
everywhere. I'd written him a letter, which I had, for want of better knowledge, sent to where I met him down the Lachlan years ago. He was shearing when I knew him, so I sent the letter to him just on spec, addressed as follows, Clancy of the Overflow. And an answer came directed in a writing unexpected. I think the same was written with a thumbnail dipped in tar. It was his shearing mate who wrote it. And verbatim, I will quote it. Clancy's gone to Queensland droving and we don't know where he are. In my wild, erratic fancy, visions come to me of Clancy gone a-droving down the Cooper where the western drovers go as the stock a-slowly stringing Clancy rides behind them singing. For the drover's life has pleasures that the townsfolk never know.
He's an Australian icon of poetry, stage and screen, a bloke who personified the Aussie male in the 1970s, an actor who has won the hearts of Hollywood and his nation, and he's won the hearts of Indigenous Australia from urban areas to outback stations.
They wanted to give me a name, they'd had some discussion about the name, and my name was to be the name of this place, which is a great honour. My name is Gulkula.
And Gulkula is determined to make a difference through his foundation.
We established the Jack Thompson Foundation to teach the skills required for people in the remote communities to house themselves now and into the future with the material available to them.
He's also passionate about poetry.
If Paterson is the heart of the Australian bush poetry tradition, then there isn't much doubt that Lawson is the soul.
And he's passionate about the Australian bush. And that's where I met the man, known to the Gumatj clan as Gulkula, otherwise known as Jack Thompson, my guest on Living Black Conversations.
Original Charter of Rights. It was written by a woman at the time called Kath Walker, Ujuru Nunukul. We want hope, not racialism. Brotherhood, not ostracism. Black advance, not white ascendance. Make us equals, not dependents. We need help, not exploitation. We want freedom, not frustration, not control, but self-reliance.
Jack, thanks very much for joining us.
My pleasure, Kat.
We're here in Northeast Arnhem Land, the land of the Yolngu people, and it's a special place, a place where you've been welcomed as a family member.
I am.
How did this close relationship with the people of this land start?
It came about as a result of my connection with Garoy's brother, who of course headed up the band Yothu Yindi. And like a lot of people, I became aware of Yothu Yindi first, sort of MTV. But then I found myself in Los Angeles working over there, and Yothu Yindi was at the Whiskey A Go-Go on Sunset Strip. So I went along and I was introduced. And so when I came back, my friend Billy Thorpe was here for the, they were mates too. So Billy was invited up here for the very first of the Garma festivals that they'd put together. And he came back and he said to me, Jack, it's right up your alley, because I talked to him about my experience in the territory as a young fellow and with the Aboriginal people there, the Aliwara. And he said, this is right in your territory, you have to go. So the next year I came That was the second of the Garma festivals, and there was a connection occurred because at the time the NT administration was trying to break up the two-way learning where the Yolngu language was being taught as the primary language and English as a second language, and they were trying to break that up, and there was a forum about the importance of the language to the culture and all of that. And I spoke at that forum in defense of maintaining this system because I recognized just how important the language is. It's an oral tradition. It's like you get rid of the language. It's like you're destroying all the libraries, all of the information handed down over millennia. And I spoke in that, and my brother was very impressed by that, and he said to me, would you say that if we had someone come from Darwin or do a television interview and someone from the press? And I said, of course I would, which I did. I had sort of threatening calls, people saying, somebody doesn't know anything about the Northern Territory, what's he talking about, and da da da. But that was just prejudice talking. But as a result of that, at the end of the that Garma festival tour, in the last day, I was invited by Galloway and his brother and the elders to come to a meeting out in the bush, something like this. And they're all gathered, and they said they wanted to make me a member of their family, and of their clan, the Gumach, and to be a Yunupingo, and they wanted to give me a name. They'd had some discussion about the name, and my name was to be the name of this place, which is a great honor. My name is Gulkula.
The name Gulkula was given to him by my late brother. Gulkula is where Garma is being held. And Jack Thompson is always welcome here. He's a regular, he's been coming out to Garma, and I couldn't see why we chose that name for him because of his generosity in being a generous bloke, I guess, you know. But the relationship there is just spot on with Jack Thompson and my family, the Gumach.
First off, my dad's a really loving and giving person, and he's always got a lot of time for anybody who needs, you know, a helping hand or anything. And I feel like the Aboriginal people have given him so much in his childhood, growing up, and everything. And it feels like he, you know, every chance he can, he'll give back to the community that has given so much to him.
So, what have you learnt from this close relationship with the Yunupingu family, and how has it impacted on your life?
What I've learnt is just how active the Yunupingus, and in fact, a lot of the people of the Yolngu and some other people across the top end here, but particularly the Yunupingus, how active they are in seeking reconciliation, seeking rights, seeking justice for their people. And there's not much doubt that Yothu Yindi brought to the attention of the world that not only was this culture alive and well, but treaty, yeah, is a call for just such rights to be recognized and just such recognition within the community. But primarily, it affects my life in this way. I'm here every year. Every year, I am reconnected to this place, to Gulkula, to the Garma, and to Yolngu and the Gumach people.
The Garma Festival is one of Australia's leading cultural exchange events held at remote Gulkula, a traditional meeting ground in Arnhem Land. This is where I caught up with Jack, who actively participates in the key forums on Indigenous issues and the celebration of cultural traditions. This is also the place where the Jack Thompson Foundation was born.
5 years ago now, we were at Garma, and there was a considerable amount of discussion about the need for Aboriginal housing. SIHEP had just been announced, and there was a young man here who in fact had come over from Cape York, from a community up there, and he was here actually looking at, from Hopeful, and he was actually looking at the dyes that they use here in the weaving, the pandanus weaving, because they're still using natural dyes here and they were not using them back there. And so he was looking at the plants that they were using and going to take that back to the community there. While he was here, this passionate discussion was going on about housing. And he had a background in timber. He'd worked in mills and cutting timber, hauling timber. And he said at one of these discussions, you know, if these people really knew how to cut the trees and to mill them with a portable mill like a Lucas mill in the bush, the timbers here, all we need to do is teach them how to build and they can build their own houses from this material. And of course, we're talking to the people themselves about what it is you want in a house. I said to one of the women, so he was talking about you want two rooms and a shelter, and I said, so what about a kitchen? And she said, no, I don't need a kitchen. Not in that house. I don't need a kitchen in the house. And I said, well, you gotta have something. And she said, where are you gonna put a buffalo in a kitchen, Jack?
Well, the relationship between the foundation, the Gumatj Corporation and Jack Thompson Foundation is just spot on. You know, I wouldn't agree more than Jack Thompson being generous in the first place and giving us giving us funding to buy what we needed the most. And that I think would have been the first sawmill that Gumatj ever owned.
Homelands are where people have been continuously living for the last 40, 60,000 years in a culturally intact way. There's about 350 language groups that are still living that way. They are in South Australia, Western Australia and the Northern Territory. However, the number of housing and the number of commercial enterprise buildings that they require is about 300 per building, per homeland. And there are 10,000 homelands in Australia. So it's not a small problem. It's not a small issue. The amount of poverty that you see in a homeland in terms of people dying of diseases you and I don't see in a city. The amount of children that have never been to school. If I was a child looking out the window in my homeland, I would wonder why I would be going to school, because the only people that are working are white people.
Well, it really is a story of self-determination.
It is, totally.
Yeah, where the people are, it's creating, you know, training and employment for them, as well as a feeling of self-empowerment for them as well.
Absolutely, so that they're not dependent on handouts or royalties, and understanding that as the Indigenous people of this country have been for millennia, they can live independent from the reticulated systems that we've superimposed on the environment.
Australia, in the last 10 years, has spent $27 billion on 2% of the population. And in the homelands that I visit, nothing has changed. The poverty that I see is in terms of diseases that people get because they're so poor and they can't eat right. And all the policy is around keeping the governance on track. It's not really about relieving poverty. The problem with policies in the past is that it's always a knee-jerk reaction. It's too hard to service outstations or small groups of people in homelands. Let's all move them all into one town. Let's call them growth towns. One of the great problems with growth towns is that people that live on country are actually, or in language groups, are actually on their own nation. When you put five nations into one town, then you're going to have World War III.
People need to be able to live there in those homelands and in those remote communities, because that is where their culture and the sacred sites have existed for thousands and thousands and thousands of years. And to remove those people from there is to remove them from their culture. And that's cultural genocide.
We want freedom, not frustration, not control, but self-reliance, independence, not compliance, not rebuff, but education, self-respect, not resignation. Free us from a mean subjection, from a bureaucratic protection. Let's forget the old-time slavers. Give us fellowship, not favors. Encouragement, not prohibitions. Homes, not settlements and missions. We need love, not overlordship. Grip of hand, not whip-hand wardship. Opportunity that places white and black on equal basis. You dishearten, not defend us. Circumscribe, who should befriend us. Give us welcome, not aversion. Give us choice, not cold coercion. Status, not discrimination. Human rights, not segregation.
Well, your connection with the Yolngu people actually started much earlier. After you finished school, you spent time on a cattle station. Can you tell us about that time in your life?
I'd love to. Take me back. I'd love to go back to that time in my life, Colin. They were not Yolngu. They were a separate language group. They were the Aliora people in the Musgrave Ranges. Of that part of the country, and I at 14, just before my 15th birthday, I went to work on a cattle station in the Northern Territory, El Kedra, and we went back there last year for my birthday, and it was the first time in 56 years that I'd been there. It was remarkable. So I, as a boy, 14, just about to turn 15, I was the only white fella out on the stock camp. And they were all Aliwara men, and they spoke their language and lived their cultural life. And the young men were initiated. And I was aware of all of those song cycles. And they treated me like their son, and I've never forgotten that. And my Aliwara name is Jagawara.
Can you tell us about your early years growing up, and you actually started life as John Hadley Payne?
Yes, my mother died just before I was five. My brother David and I were placed by my aunt and my father. My father had returned from the war and was unable to look after my brother and myself. And my aunt, who now lives in America, who's 92, and still hale and hearty, still dancing. I hope I can be doing that. I said that to her. I hope I'm still dancing at 92. And she said, well, you better start dancing more, Jack. she had said, what are we going to do with these two boys? She said, we might have to place them in an orphanage. And the doctor working with her father, who was also a doctor, said, don't do that. There's this school down at Narrabeen, and there, it's a boarding school for kids, and it's really good, run by these two women. So we were placed there, we were boarded there. And we saw our father a couple of times, but then there were also day pupils coming to the school, boys and girls, who were the sons and daughters of all sorts of people living up around Narrabeen, Collaroy at the time. Stan Halls, who was the director of the then Commonwealth Film Unit, his two daughters were there. John Thompson, who was a senior feature writer and producer for ABC Radio and had been an ABC war correspondent, had his son Peter there, and Peter and I became best friends. We did everything together. We were about just going on 6 when we first met. And so I used to go to his place on weekends. Not every weekend, but every now and then. And if there was a school holiday, if he wasn't going away somewhere, I'd stay at his place. And in the end, they wanted to adopt a child, to have a second child in the family. And they said, why would we go looking elsewhere? There's this boy who's Peter's best friend and no one able to look after him. So they applied for adoption, and I became officially Jack Thompson instead of Jack Payne.
So what was it like growing up in the Thompson family?
It was a great pleasure. Great pleasure. John Thompson was a writer, poet. I didn't realise until much later after I'd left home that the Thompsons, Pat and John Thompson, were wonderful hosts. She was a wonderful cook. He did some cooking, but she was a very, very good cook. And they ran what you would recognise as a salon. They deliberately invited people to dinner, mixed these people with those people because they thought that would make for interesting conversation. So we were brought up in a house of a lot of conversation and debate. And he was a classic scholar, and he lived in his library and wrote at home and wrote scripts at home for the ABC. What I wanted to be was a scientist after World War II. I think every boy wanted to be a scientist. That was the new modern world. That's what we all wanted to be. We were all into science fiction and Dan Dare comics and all of that. But I went off to work on the cattle station. Just before I went to work on the cattle station, I was at Sydney High, and every year the school play was performed, the set play for what was then called the Leaving Certificate, the HSC, was performed on the War Memorial steps in Sydney's Hyde Park. And it was Henry V, and I played Henry V. And they had a police horse provided and a suit of armour, and it was a kid's dream. And I can still remember lines from Henry V the speech of the Battle of Agincourt and all of that. But that was it, and then I was going off to work on the cattle station. As we left the house, my father said to me, you don't want to be an actor, do you, Johnny? I looked at him and was like, where did that come from? It's like, you don't want to be a cook, you don't want to be a plumber, what? Where did that come from? I'm off to work on a cattle station. But he knew. And I can remember him looking at me with a smile on his face. He said, just remember, lilies that fester stink worse than weeds. I had a bit of a think, and I thought, I think he's telling me I should give it a shot.
Well, you're one of our country's greatest actors, with leading roles in movies such as Breaker Morant and The Man from Snowy River and The Sum of Us with Russell Crowe, and many more roles. What role has meant the most to you, and the role that you're most proud of?
All of those films have their own wonderful qualities. But considering where we are and our discussion, the picture that I think has probably had in a number of ways a most profound effect, and one that I am very proud to be involved with, is Australia. I think that Australia brought to the screen for the first time a number of things. The Stolen Generation. But as much as the Stolen Generation, and for me, because of my own experience on the cattle station, even more, it brought for the first time to the screen the fact that the entire pastoral industry of this country's north was only possible because of the Indigenous men and women who worked the stock and who I worked with when I was 15 on that cattle station. So for me, when we were out there out of Kununurra on the river and they had recreated the cattle station and there were the Aboriginal men and women there working with the stock, it was like I had stepped into a time machine and all those years had gone, here I was again.
Well, our country's going through a great change and challenge, I guess you could say, at the moment with the relationships between black and white in this country and the push for constitutional recognition.
Yeah.
How hopeful are you that this change will occur in the future?
It had better. I don't think we can continue to hold our head high and say that we're a democracy and that we're proud to be Australians unless there is constitutional change, constitutional recognition. Recognition? How can we not recognise that the people of the oldest continual cultural stream on the planet were here when we arrived and are still here? How can we deny that? It's imperative that that constitutional change occur.
You, the law, like Roman Pontius, make us proud, not colour conscious. Give the deal you still deny us. Give goodwill, not bigot bias. Give ambition, not prevention. Confidence, not condescension. Make us mates, not poor relations. Citizens, not serfs on stations. Must we native old Australians in our land rank as aliens? Banish bands and conquer caste. Then we'll win our own at last.